With me tonight. Welcome to Midweek with Pastor. This is our first week of Easter edition, so I invite you to lift your voice with me tonight, and let's lift our hearts up to the Lord, and let's sing praise to Him tonight. Amen. Give Him thanks and praise, and maybe while we sing, some others will join us as well tonight as we lift our heart up to the Lord. Amen. Amen. Sing an old chorus along with the church with me tonight.
God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll find life's final war with pain. And then this day gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and alone He reigns. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, He holds the future, and life is worth living just because He lives. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth living just because He lives.
Amen. Amen. Tonight we're going to be talking in just a minute from John 14 through 16. The great passage that Jesus gave us before He departed this world. Amen. And so I'm going to sing a little bit tonight about a couple things, just to prepare our hearts for for the moments that we have together. Amen. Two great themes that pop up in this passage are going to be the Holy Spirit and the promise of heaven. Amen. So let's sing a little bit about them tonight. Amen. Let's sing tonight with me about the promise of heaven just a little bit. Sing this whole hymn with me tonight.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us. Soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the skies. Oh, what singing, oh, what shouting on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory, hallelujah, when we meet our blessed Savior in the skies. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon His face, the one who saved me by His grace. When He takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon His face, the one who saved me by His grace. When He takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. Come, Holy Spirit, I need Thee. Come, sweet Spirit, I pray. Come in Thy strength and Thy power. Come in Thy own gentle way. Come, Holy Spirit, I need Thee. Come, sweet Spirit, I pray. Come in Thy strength and Thy power. Come in Thine own gentle way.
Amen. Amen. Thanks for singing with me tonight. If you have your Bible, I'm going to shift over to where my Bible is located, and you can find John the 14th chapter tonight.
That's where we're going to be looking. John 14. John 14 through 16 is a great little passage tonight. Amen. So we're going to begin there tonight. And it's great to see so many of you jumping on with me tonight. John 14 through 16 is what we're going to be looking together in just a minute. Amen. Good to see Mindy and RJ and Gwen and Shannon and Victoria. And I got several folks hopping on with me tonight. Thank y'all. Let me know you're over here in the comments section as you hop on tonight. Amen. John 14 through 16 is where we're going to be looking tonight. This is a great little passage. It's tucked right in between the John 13 passage, which is the Last Supper and where Jesus washes his disciples' feet, and John 17, where we have the high priestly prayer of Jesus, the prayer that Jesus prays before he goes to the cross. And in between these two events, you've got these neat little bookends. You've got these two things that I just mentioned bookend a conversation, a very intimate conversation between Jesus and his disciples. And it's not just any of the disciples, it's the 11 who remain. Judas has already left. He's exited. He's left the room to go prepare to betray Jesus. So Jesus is now with his most intimate followers, those who love him and know him best. And he has a lot to say to them in chapters 14 through 16. So if you're looking for something good to read, John 14 through 16 is a great little place to camp out during this Easter season. I was hoping to get to this before Easter, but I didn't. I said, well, tonight let's jump back to it because I believe it's very important for the Easter season, these three chapters. I think they're full of good stuff for us. And here's why. When Jesus is preparing to leave and he's letting them know that he's about to go to the cross, but also that even after the cross, he's about to depart this world. And so he's trying to prepare them for that reality. He's made a prediction about his imminent death and his soon departure, even after his resurrection back to the Father. And the disciples are upset about it. They're not happy. They are troubled by this. And Jesus reaches out to them in this time, the night before his own death, and he tries to comfort them. Isn't that just like Jesus? Jesus is facing his own dark hour, and yet he's trying to prop somebody else up in their dark hour. Maybe we are never more like Jesus than when we are going through something ourselves and we still find the strength and energy to take care of somebody else. Amen? Even in Jesus' last night, he wasn't just focused and fixated on himself. Even at the darkest, most painful moment of Jesus' journey, he's focused on others. That's a great lesson for us. Even at the cross we studied last week, he's worried about his mother, Mary, and he's focused in on her. Well, tonight, when we read John 14 through 16, even though he is about to go to the cross the very next morning, tonight, he's not just focused on himself. We know he has that moment in the garden, but at the beginning here, he's focused on the disciples, and he says some neat things to them. He says to them twice in this passage, do not let your heart be troubled. And he begins and ends the passage with encouragement. He says at the beginning, let not your heart be troubled. And at the end, in chapter 16, verse 33, he says, be of good cheer. So that's kind of interesting to me. He gives these encouraging words to them. Even in the darkest hour, he gives them encouragement. Again, how like Jesus to give us encouragement in the darkest hour, both his and ours. But twice he says, do not let your heart be troubled. He says it in chapter 14, verse 1, and he says it again in chapter 14, verse 27. But there are two different reasons. There's a different reason each time he says it. And I want us to unpack that a little bit tonight before I let you go and you jump on with your other Bible studies or practices or events tonight, wherever else you may be joining us at 7. I want you to notice there's two reasons Jesus gives why we don't have to be troubled, why our hearts don't have to be troubled. The first one is because of where he's going. Look at chapter 14, verses 1 through 6. If you know any passage or any words of Jesus outside the Beatitudes, you probably know this passage. John 14, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I am going, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. So this is the first thing that Jesus says to us about why we don't have to be discouraged or why our hearts don't have to be troubled. It's because of where he is going. And he gives us four great gifts in that little first part of the passage. Number one, he gives us peace. Don't let your heart be troubled. Number two, he gives us a place. I'm going to prepare a place for you. Number three, he gives us a promise. And if I go, I will come again and take you there with me. And then finally, he gives a path. Where I'm going, you know, and you know how to get there. And when Thomas questions him on that, he says, I am the path to get there. Jesus is the way. So we don't have to worry about the distant future because of the promise of heaven. Jesus gives us this promise. It's a beautiful promise. So we don't have to worry about the distant future because of heaven. That's something good for us to remember, right? Right now, we look into the future. It seems very uncertain and very dark. And Jesus says, number one, in order to keep your heart encouraged and keep your spirits up, he said, I want you to just fast forward to the end with me. Fast forward to the end and remember that at the end of the story, you're going to be with me. One of my favorite songs right now by Alan Asbury is an old song called In the Father's House. And there's a great one little line in that song, and it says, and the story isn't over if the story isn't good. Isn't that great? The story isn't over if the story isn't good. Well, if your story isn't good, it isn't over. And so that's the truth that Jesus is telling them, even though they are facing a dark hour in the passage. And in John 15 and 16, he warns them that in the future, they're going to face many dark hours. He warns them about persecution. That's one of the themes in these three chapters is you will be persecuted. Even at the end in chapter 16, he says, in the world, you will have tribulation, but take heart, I've overcome the world. So Jesus warns them right off the cuff. Things are going to get tough. Things are tough now. There are dark moments. There are difficult spots in the journey if you live for Jesus. And yet Jesus says, fast forward to the end. And when this is all over, when everything is said and done, when the story ends, you will be with me in the Father's house. You will be with me. That's a great promise. As the old saints used to say, I read the back of the book and we win. And that reality ought to anchor us. We have that hope, the Bible says, the hope of Jesus coming. We have this blessed hope as an anchor for the soul. Amen. And so that's one of our anchors. So we have an anchor in the distant future. And that anchor is the blessed hope that Jesus will come again and receive us to himself. And we will forever be with the Lord. The promise of heaven. We don't have to be worried about the distant future because of the promise of heaven. But then Jesus says it again in 14:27, do not let your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Only this time he hasn't been talking about the promise of heaven. He's been talking about the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's the second reason we don't have to be discouraged or troubled tonight. Don't be discouraged or troubled because of the promise of heaven, number one. And number two, because of the presence of the Holy Spirit. And Jesus tells them, he says, listen, I know you're saddened to hear that I'm going away from you and I won't physically be present with you anymore. But Jesus says, the reality is it's good news for you. It is a good thing. He said, it is expedient for you. That means it is the best thing for you if I go away. Because if I don't go away, the Comforter won't come. But if I go away, I will send him to you, and he's going to be even better than my physical presence with you. That's a pretty big deal. For the disciples who were used to being able to have Jesus physically present with them, to see him, to touch him, to go to him, to feel his hand on their shoulder, to hear his voice with their own ears, to see the love in his eyes and his expressions, that was enormous. The presence of Jesus was a great comfort to them. And to think about going forward without that was terrifying. But Jesus promised them that the Holy Spirit would be an even better comforter than he could be to them going forward into the future. That's amazing. Three times in this passage, he will talk about the Holy Spirit. In chapter 14, verses 15 through 18, again in verses 25 to 27, and then over in chapter 16, he will talk about him for 10 verses, chapter 16, verses 5 to 15. And he says some things about the Holy Spirit. I want you to notice two things that he calls him and then several things that he'll do. The first thing he calls him is he says, I'm going to send you another comforter or another helper. Another is the key word. Say another. The word another is a beautiful word in the Greek because there's two words for other. One of the words is heteros. It's where we get this idea of You know, heterosexual means different. A man and a woman are different and they come together. Heteros means different. Means other, but it means other of a different way. But then there's this little Greek word, allos, A-L-L-O-S, if we transliterate it. And it means another of the same kind. Not the same one, but one just like the one you had. That's the word Jesus uses for the Holy Spirit. He says, I'm going to heaven, but I'm going to send you another just like me. I'm going to send you a comforter just like me. He's going to be everything that I was to you. He's going to be just like having me in your heart, in your life, with you 24/7. That is a great promise. That is the promise of the Holy Spirit, that he will be everything to us. Jesus was to his disciples, and he will be ever present with us. So he is another comforter. Say another. Another of the same kind, just like Jesus. That's the promise of the Spirit. Number two, the word Jesus uses, sometimes it's translated comforter. Lots of times it's translated helper. I think that's a great word. It's really the word paraclete is the Greek word, and it comes from two words. Para means beside, and kaleo is to call. And so he's called alongside. He's called beside us. He's called to walk alongside us. He is our companion in this life. He is our helper. That's a great word. Helper is a word that is rich in the Old Testament. God is our saving help. The Hebrew word is etzer. He's our Ebenezer, Ebenezer. Here I raise my Ebenezer, the hymn writer says. Ebenezer, stone of help, rock of help. Jesus, God is our rock of help. Psalm 46 comes to mind, right? God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. Other places in the Psalms, the Lord is my helper. The Lord is my shade on my right hand, Psalm 121. So over and over in the Bible, we get these promises that God is our help. He is our very present help. He's the helper. Women, it's also interesting to me to think about that this term for the Holy Spirit is also the word that God uses to describe Adam's wife. Adam calls her Eve, but God calls her a helpmeet, etzer, a helper. And so whenever the Bible says that the wife is a helper to the man, he doesn't mean she's the cook or the maid or the housekeeper. No. It's the same word used to describe the presence of God in our lives. It is saving help. It is rescuer. It is a life saver. It is someone you don't know what you would do without. Someone you probably couldn't make it without. That's the word. And so everything that a spouse or a companion can be to us, all the comfort and strength and help that that person can be in our life. Jesus says that's a very similar thing to what the Holy Spirit is going to be for you as you walk with God. He's going to be this ever-present, constant companion. And what is he going to do? Well, the Bible says that he will abide with us. Jesus says, I'm going to leave and go to the Father, but I'm going to send you a comforter that won't ever leave. He'll always be there. He will abide with you forever. I almost sang it tonight. One of my favorite songs about the Holy Spirit is that old hymn, he abides, hallelujah, he abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me. He stays, he remains, he abides, he lives with us. Another word Jesus used to describe him in these verses is, it says, not only does he abide, but it says he reminds. He says in chapter 14 that the Holy Spirit will remind you of all the things that I've said to you. Whenever we hide God's word in our heart, it is the Holy Spirit who reminds us of what we've learned in the moments that we need it most. He brings to our remembrance the things that we need to remember. And how many times has God done that for you? He's reminded you of a Bible verse, or maybe something from a sermon, or maybe the lines of an old song, a gospel song that you've hidden in your heart. Whenever you hide good things in your heart, the Holy Spirit has a way of bringing them to your remembrance just at the moment that you need them both, that you need them most. Sometimes it's a memory of God's past faithfulness and how you made it through and how God came through for you. Sometimes it's a part of your story, or maybe a testimony or a story you heard from another Christian. But the Holy Spirit brings to our remembrance the things we've learned, and he helps us. He abides and he reminds. And then he reveals, the Bible says. Jesus said, I haven't been able to teach you everything in the time that I was with you, but that's okay. The Holy Spirit is going to complete your education. He's going to teach you the things that I haven't been able to teach you yet. He will reveal truth to you. He will take what belongs to me and he will show it to you. That's amazing. The Holy Spirit is going to take the words of Jesus and unveil them, reveal them to us. I want to tell you There is no teacher like the Holy Spirit. And one of the things I learned from my dad didn't have a lot of formal education. He didn't make it through high school. He made it through about the sixth grade. But my dad, after he was filled with the Holy Spirit, would sit down with the King James Bible and he would read and he would pray. And I have never met a layperson with a better grasp on the Bible than my father. And he says he was taught by the Holy Spirit. I want to tell you tonight, if you'll get alone with the Bible and you'll get on your knees and pray and ask the Holy Spirit to reveal the truth to you, the Holy Spirit is a revealer. And if you'll let him fill your life, he'll unlock the book to you. He'll make the book live for you. Amen. So the Holy Spirit is he's a revealer. He's a reminder. He's an abider and he's a convictor. And this is the part we sometimes don't like as much. But chapter 16, he says, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will convict the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. Convict. He points out the sin in our lives, the things that are wrong. He convinces us of our need of a Savior. And he makes our testimony convincing to others. Every Christian, if we're going to be a witness in this world, needs the Holy Spirit, his convicting witness to go with us. I want to tell you, when you're preaching or your testimony or your sharing of the faith doesn't seem to be very effective, pray and ask God to anoint it. Ask the Holy Spirit to go with you into those conversations. Because the Holy Spirit has a way of touching other people's hearts when we talk to them about the Lord. And he can do something in their heart that our words will never be able to do alone. He can bring conviction. He can convince them that they're not right with God and that they need to be saved and that they need to turn to the Lord. These are the things the Holy Spirit does. It's beautiful. Well, I want to remind you tonight, the Gospels all end with go. Matthew 28, go and therefore and make disciples of the nations. Mark 16, go and preach the gospel to every creature. The Gospels end with go, but the book of Acts begins with wait. Wait. He doesn't say go. At the beginning of Acts, Jesus says wait. It's almost like he says, hey, go. But before you do, don't forget this one thing. Just before you rush out the door, remember, I'm not calling you to work for me. I'm calling you to work with me. And so Jesus tells them, before you go, you need to not leave Jerusalem and try to do anything I've commanded you to do until you receive this helper, this comforter, this companion, this other that I'm going to send to you. And so in Acts 1, 4, and 5, it says, he commands them, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he says, you will receive not many days from now. For John truly baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Have you received the Holy Spirit? Since you've been a Christian, have you been filled with the Holy Spirit? Can I urge you? God wants to do that for you. He wants you to be filled with His Spirit. If you've never done that, begin to seek like the disciples did. Begin to get curious and earnest and seek the Lord and get before Him and ask Him, Lord, I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Between now and Pentecost Sunday, begin to seek. Jesus has promised us that the Holy Spirit is a great gift and He wants us to have Him in all His fullness in our heart and our life. So before I go, remember, you don't have to be troubled tonight. You don't have to be worried about the distant future because of the promise of heaven. But you don't have to be worried about the immediate future either because of the presence of the Holy Spirit. He's our promise. We're going to pray. We're going to go tonight, and I'm going to let you hop onto your Bible study groups. Remember, this Saturday on Fox 10 at 10 o'clock, join us the next two Saturdays, Fox 10 at 10 o'clock. We'll have our 30-minute television broadcast going on there, and don't forget about that. And then Sunday morning, 10 o'clock, kids service, 10:30, online worship. We'll continue to do that. I hope you enjoyed the parking lot prayer meeting. It was so good to see y'all there. We'll try to schedule another one of those for sometime soon. We're thinking about maybe a Sunday afternoon, late afternoon, to get together to do that. But we'll give you more details about that. Amen. I'm so glad. Love you much. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for your kindness and your love. I pray that you would abide with my friends tonight. And Lord, keep our eyes fixed on the hope of heaven and the promise of the Spirit with us. Your presence and your promises keep us in these difficult times. Lord, bless our friends. Bless those who are struggling tonight. Give them the grace and consolation of your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right. Hop onto your Bible study groups. God bless.